Welcome to the virtual sanctuary of Christ Missionary Baptist Church. We are so glad that you have decided to worship with us today. We're expecting God to move in a fresh way. So come on into the virtual sanctuary and let's worship the Lord together.
Glory, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Anybody else glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Well, listen, if you're at home, you're still in the house of the Lord. Come on, play that again, play that again. Listen, make your house a sanctuary this morning. Praise Him, praise. morning, it is so on me. I was up last night and I really couldn't sleep. I just couldn't rest. It wasn't like a restless, like I was disturbed. It was just my excitement about being in the house of the Lord was unusual last night. I don't know why, because it's not always like that. Sometimes it's a pull and it's a tussle to get out of the bed and get ready and be at 7:30 sound check. But this last night, I was excited because I felt like something was going to happen and something was going to break in this atmosphere this morning. But in order for that to happen, when the woman with the alabaster box came and she said, I'm going to anoint the feet of Jesus, something broke before she received.
It did.
She had to break something open. Yes. She had to pour something out.
Yeah.
She had to give something in order to receive something. So when we're saying, here's my worship, all of my worship, that sounds and it looks like something. It doesn't have to be loud. It doesn't have to be any of that, but it has to be present. And in order for the Lord to do what he wants to do this morning, we have to be with one accord. Everybody lift your hands and close your eyes. Don't even look at me. Don't look at the women that's singing, but close your eyes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you. Come on, even if you have a mask on, open your voice is still in the room. Open your mouth and honor the Lord. Come on, give him your worship. What does your worship sound like in your kitchen? What does your worship sound like in your bedroom? What does your worship sound like when you're at home? What does your worship sound like in your car? What does it sound like? Prepare this room like you do on your own. Bring your individual time of worship into you're worthy of it.
bless your name, God. He is worthy to be praised. Every day that the sun rises and it sets is a reminder that he is worthy of all of our available praise for as long as we live. It's now time for our call to worship. We will read it responsibly, and you will find it on the screens. And it reads, "Blessed be the Lord, God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen." And together, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say amen. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, CNBC. This is our centering moment. And we are so grateful to be in the house of the Lord today, amen, on this Sisterhood Sunday, amen. We give God praise today. We know that God is our all in all, and without God, we could be nothing. And so we say today to God, we bless your name. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name. Today on this Sisterhood Sunday, we want to remember those who are bereaved: Linda and Reginald Tompkins, Nakia Love, Alicia Jones, Ina Jones, and Willie Jones Jr., and Reverend Audrey and John Taylor. In the hospital or rehabilitation center, we want to remember Chestina Turner and Renata Vassar. With upcoming surgery, we want to remember Director Joanne Nicholson and Torin Thornton. And we want to continue in prayer for Pat Broadnax, Deacon Emeritus Pauline Phillips, Blanche Johnson, John and Bonnie Barlow, Olean Sane, Betty Sutton, Bobby Bowen, Deacon Emeritus Tom and Maddie Cooper, Deacon Emeritus Ozane Turner, Bishop William Young, Micaiah Perkins, Veronica Perkins Sims, Tammy Gilchrist, Deacon Freddie Payton, Deacon Director Stephanie Payton, Dr. Cyrilyn Walters, James Wilson, Barbara Clemens, and we always want to remember in prayer our own pastor, the Reverend Dr. Gina Marcia Stewart. Amen. We know that the mantle on her life is a great mantle and a heavy burden. And we always want to lift her up in prayer, because the enemy doesn't necessarily have to go after each one of us. As long as the enemy can get the head, he can turn the body. So let's remember her in prayer today. As we go before the Lord, let's pray. God of our fathers and God of our sisters, God of Sarah and Rahab, and God of Rebecca, God, we thank you today. God, we give you all praise. We thank you for Jesus. We can never forget the sacrifice that was made by Jesus, who gave us life, and by you, who gave your son. We are so grateful to you today, oh God. We don't stop for any pretense today, oh God. We're going to get out of your way so you can do your thing in this house today, oh God. We need you, Lord. There's so much going on in our world today, oh God, that we need you. So we give up everything today. We relinquish all hold on those things that we withheld from you today, oh God. Work in our lives today, oh God. Do your thing, God. Have your way today, God. We give you all praise, oh God. And we give you permission, oh God, to throw your weight around. Have your way, Lord. Fix us, God. Change us, God. Help us, God, to do your will, God. so that our lives may be changed. Oh God, we ask you to fix this world, oh God. Oh, there's so much going on. And if we listen to the press, God, we would just fall down and give it up. But we've got somebody that we can trust, oh God. Your name, oh God. The name of Jesus, oh God. We know is a stronghold and a refuge in a time of trouble. We know you can fix Ukraine and Russia and the crazy leaders, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And so we give them up to you, God, in the name of Jesus. We don't act as if we have no hope, for our hope is in you, God. And your track record is clear, oh God. We pray for the women in Iran, oh God, today. We pray for women all over this world, oh God, who don't enjoy the freedoms that we have, oh God. But we thank you, God, because we don't act like we got some certain privilege that only belongs to us, oh God. For you are the God of freedom and justice, oh God. And we thank you, God, that we're growing up in a time where we can pray for those who don't share what we share. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name, God, today. We give you all praise today, oh God. Now come in this worship service, oh God, and throw yourself around, not just here, Lord, but all over the world, oh God, where your name is lifted up. For it is your name that breaks the stronghold. It is the anointing that breaks the stronghold, oh God. So stand up in the preacher today, oh God. Lift her up, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We know she's done her study, oh God, but she needs your spirit. So we thank you today. We open our minds and our hearts that we might hear your word, oh God, that our life may be different, that we may be changed. Not just us, oh God, but when we share this word, oh God, we pray that others might be changed also, that they may run and say, who is the God that you serve? We thank you today, God. We bless your name today, God, and we give you all thanks and praise. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
God bless you. Our congregational hymn remains hymn number 27 in the New National Baptist Hymnal, Blessed Assurance. We will sing it in its entirety.
Stay tuned for your weekly updates. October is Clergy Appreciation Month. It is time set aside to recognize the contributions and service of pastors and clergy. We invite you to show your appreciation to our pastor and ministers who faithfully serve throughout the year. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. The Memphis Mobile Mammography Clinic will be at CNBC on Saturday, October 22nd. To schedule an appointment, you may visit www.methodisthealth.org/wellness or call the Administrative Service Office at 901-948-9786. Join the Village Student Ministry for Hallelujah Night, Monday, October 31st, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., located in the front parking lot across the street. There will be food, fun, and games. Appropriate costumes are encouraged. The Cancer Education and Outreach Internship Program is offering internship opportunities for college students who are juniors, seniors, or grad students, or individuals who are seeking careers in science or K-12 science education and public health in the Memphis area. Interns will facilitate the St. Jude After School STEM Clubs in select elementary schools or the St. Jude Community Health Club in selected middle schools in the Memphis area. This internship runs from January 30th, 2023 to May 29th, 2023. The deadline to submit cover letter and resume is Friday, December 16th, 2022. You may visit www.stjude.org for more information. Are you a Black female leader in a faith-based space? Do you live in the South? Meharry Medical College would like to learn about your attitude and experiences with sexual health and HIV prevention. If you are interested in participating, you may call 615-428-4401. Your gifts make a difference and help us to facilitate local and global ministry. If you would like to be a part of this kingdom work, we invite you to invest in this ministry as you are able. Stay connected to CNBC during the week. Follow us on all social media platforms and sign up to receive our text blast by texting CNBC to 84576. Remember, wearing a mask and getting vaccinated helps to keep you, your family, and community safe. All announcements must be submitted and emailed to announcements@christmbc.org by Wednesday at 12 noon. Thank you for your attention. Have a great day.
Well, could you stand on your feet and give God praise? For this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Come on, put your hands together on this sisterhood Sunday. And we give God praise for the music ministry and for Minister Alicia Peters Jordan. Can you put your hands together as we welcome her back again for the second time? We love her. She's such a gift and a blessing with a deep spirituality. And I'm grateful for her ministry on today. Do me a favor, if you haven't already done so, take a moment and like and share this worship experience with a friend, with a colleague, with a family member, with someone who needs to be inspired today. There is a word from the Lord. Our preacher is in the house. Dr. Jacqueline Thompson is going to bless us today, and we are excited about it. Whether you're in your house or in this house, this is normally our virtual worship experience, but because it's Sisterhood Sunday, we invited you to join us in the sanctuary. So we're grateful for visitors who are with us, whether you are in the sanctuary or in your own sanctuary of your home. Take a moment, if you're watching us virtually, to complete the connect card that is in the comment section on the website. And then if you're here in the sanctuary, we invite you to meet us in the lobby after service, where we will have a gift for you to show our appreciation and to express our thanks to you for coming to worship with us. We're a church that believes in hospitality, and we are glad that out of all of the places you could have gone today, you chose to worship with us, and we are glad about it. Well, you've heard it mentioned that October October is Clergy Appreciation Month, and today we are grateful that in just a few moments, I want to acknowledge some of the clergy that serve here at our church. But before I do that, let me thank God for all of the women that are singing on this morning. Come on, put your hands together. For the sisters that are singing, some new faces are up there. Come on, clap your hands. Joy Lynn Holmes and Minister Beverly Washington and Melinda Wright and Tish is up there. And Joanne Parker and Ina Jones and Demita Shaw and Alicia Jones. Come on, put your hands together for all of the women that came to help us out today. We give God praise for them. And after service, we will have some light refreshments. We want to thank God for the brothers, Brother Bobby Phillips, as well as Minister Alfred Burford, Deacon Anthony, Deacon Tobias Towers, Anson Johnson, Kayshawn Britt, and Brian Dandridge, who are helping the brothers prepare refreshments for us. Let's put our hands together for them as well. We want to express and wish a happy birthday to the following senior jewels. Mother Arnett Hill, she turned 80. She looks good, doesn't she? She told me, she said, I'm going to live to be 103 years old. I said, it wouldn't surprise me because your mother lived to be in her 90s. You have good genes, and we praise God for her presence here in our congregation, and we thank God that God has let her live to see 80 years. Amen. 80 years. Put your hands together and give God praise. And then we want to thank God for our staff and volunteers, Deacon James Kennard, who is our faithful bass player, Dr. Felicia Fowler, who is our faithful assistant director of media, and Kayshawn Britt, who is also works in media and thinks he's everybody's boss. We put our hands together for these staff and volunteers for their faithful service on this day, and we're thankful that God let them live. Then we want to wish a happy anniversary to Deacon Kenny and Lisa Williams. They've been married 19 years. Chancer and LaQuinta Brakefield have been married 3 years, and Kimberly and Antonio Ratliff have been married 14 years. Can we celebrate these couples on today? I am so grateful for the fellowship that we shared on yesterday as we went to watch, to view. We had a private viewing of The Woman King at the Paradiso Theater, and what a time we had. On this evening at 7 o'clock Central Standard Time, Dr. Renita Weems will engage us in a Bible study, looking at some of the themes of sisterhood and just doing a Bible study around The Woman King. You do need to register for it. It will be virtual, but I want to encourage you to meet us in the Zoom room this evening at 7 p.m. for our Ladies Night Out installment with Dr. Renita Weems. Let me remind you that early voting begins on October 19th. Somebody shout October 19th. Come on, say it with me again. October 19th through November 3rd. And if you have not already recognized it, this is a critical season. Come on, talk to me, somebody. I say it's a critical season. And so you never want to sit it out. But every time you sit out an election, you do de facto voter suppression. I heard Pastor Mike McBride say that. He said that when we sit out the voting process, it is a form of de facto voter suppression, because when we don't vote, we cast a vote anyway. And we let a small percentage of people decide who's going to make decisions and write policy for us. If you have not been paying attention to the news, there are critical issues that are at stake. We cannot afford to sleep through this. I say this every time there's an election, because each time democracy becomes more fragile. And so I want to encourage you to vote October 19th through November 3rd, early registration, early voting, I'm sorry. You can vote anywhere. You don't have to find your precinct. You can vote anywhere in the city where there is an early voting precinct available. Mark your calendars. Make sure your family votes, your children vote. I would like to see our church with at least a 75% voting percentage at Christ Missionary Baptist Church. What a tribute it would be to my pastor and predecessor, Reverend Eddie Curry, who had a very social justice orientation and who was very committed to participating in the political process. He understood the importance of casting our vote. And so I'm encouraging you to make sure you vote October 19th through November 3rd. This month is Cancer Awareness Month. It's Domestic Awareness Month. Domestic Violence Awareness Month. It's also Clergy Appreciation Month. Now, I want to take a moment and thank these preachers that share in our congregation, who serve in the ministry of care, who serve as intercessors, who serve in administrative leadership, who serve in outreach and evangelism and worship and arts and safety and the ministry of helps. It is because they serve that our congregation is a healthier and more vital congregation. And so I want to ask them, as I call your name, if you all would come up, Jackie and Phyllis, I want to take a moment and just give them a gift in appreciation for their service for Clergy Appreciation Month. It was established in 1992 with a mission of uplifting and encouraging pastors and religious workers. And so today, this is a way that we can say thank you to these preachers and ministers who serve. I'm first going to ask the pastors who serve to come up here. Pastor Chuck Lester, who is our executive pastor. Pastor Natalie Dunnigan, who is our pastor of congregational care. Pastor Deborah Carter, you can clap your hands. You could do better than that. These folks serve all year long. Pastor Marilyn Smith, who is our pastor of disciple development. And Pastor Kenita Hill, who is not here today because she's traveling. That's right. Give them a standing ovation. They come to see you. They pray for you. They listen to you. They talk to you. They encourage you. And today we want to say thank you to them. Amen. You would give them, would you give each one of them a card? This is just a small token of appreciation for your service and your ministry to our church. I'm going to ask the other ministers that are here if you will come up at this time. Well, before you do that, let me recognize two other ministers, Reverend Deborah Flagg and Elder Billy Rivers. Come on, clap your hands. We have a gift for them, and we are grateful for their ministry and for their service to the body of Christ. I'm going to ask all the other ministers that are in the house, if you'll come on up. I'm not going to call your name. You know who you are. Dr. Stacy Dandridge. I forgot to call her up with the pastors because she's a director of worship. I mean, media. Dr. Cynthia Mitchell, Minister Wanda Taylor. I said I wasn't going to call their name, didn't I? Reverend Audrey Taylor, Reverend Angela Minfield Cooley, Dr. Margaret Summers, and Minister Essence Jackson. Come on and clap your hands. And my baby that's back there with the camera, Minister Christopher Harris, and of course, Reverend Richard Edwards, who has been here throughout the pandemic. We give God praise for all of these preachers. Now, would you help me celebrate these preachers and thank God for their service on today? Amen. We are grateful for all of them, for the way that they serve, for them availing themselves to be a blessing to this congregation. And I am grateful for their support and for their... Minister Burford is over there. There he is. He's in the kitchen. Come on, clap your hand. He's back there with an apron on. We thank God for all of them. And let me just say happy clergy and clergy appreciation month to all of you. God bless you. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your dedication. Thank you, God bless you for the examples that you set. Thank you for helping to love this congregation. Thank you for helping to care for the congregation. Thank you for answering the call to ministry and for coming to this congregation. We are better because God sent you here. Can we put our hands together and give God praise for all these preachers? You all may be returned to you. Wait, no, stay right there. Let me get a picture. Is Sean in here? Lord. Oh, Pastor Chuck said, hold up your card. Adrian, please. Thank you. Amen. Would you put your hands together in celebration of all these preachers? We'll get another one after service. We also, Minister Chris, you didn't come get your card. Minister Christopher Harris, he's our intern that's been here with us for the last few weeks. And he's already been a blessing, and we thank God for him. I want you to help me welcome our preacher for today, Dr. Jackie Thompson, who's going to be preaching. She is the first female elected to serve as the senior pastor at the Allen Temple Baptist Church in Oakland, California. And we are so grateful that she could come and be with us today. And she is the newly elected second vice president for the Progressive National Baptist Convention, which means that in about 4 years or 6 years, four, 6 years. In 6 years, she will rise to the office of president as the first female president. Come on, clap your hands, ladies and gentlemen, of the Progressive National Baptist Convention. And we are grateful that she is here with us today. Well, it's giving time now, and if you will get your offering together. As you're getting your offering together, let me remind you that it's Communion Sunday, and that we will worship at the table of our Lord on today. And so we ask that you would prepare your gifts. Your weekly support is critical to the fulfillment of mission here at CMBC. You know that we are a church that supports worship, that your dollars support ministry, that they support outreach, that your dollars support congregational care. Your dollars make it possible to have full-time staff, so that when you're in need of someone to come and hold your hand in death or in sickness or in tragedy, there is someone who is supported by this ministry because of your liberal giving, whose sole assignment is to serve this congregation. It's one of the reasons why your pastor can get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to come and see about you when you have death or trouble, because you support this church with your gifts and your finances. It's one of the reasons why this church is able to support the poor, the marginalized, and the disenfranchised. And it's because of your giving that we have been able to be consistent in our ministry to the ends of the earth. The media ministry is placing the giving options on the screen. In fact, the men last Sunday fed the homeless downtown because of your gifts. And they do that on a regular basis, I believe once a month, usually every second or third, first Sunday of the month. But all of this is possible because all of this costs money. Amen. And the reason why we're able to do it consistently is because you give. And so the media ministry has placed the giving options on the screen. You may give electronically. You may give by sending your gift in. Or you may join us in giving here in the sanctuary. But whatever you do, I am inviting you, as you are able, to support this work so that we might continue to be a blessing to the ends of the earth. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, as we bring our gifts to the Lord. And so, God, we say thank you, because everything we have is a gift from you. We don't take it lightly. We say thank you, Lord. All that we've needed, your hand has provided. You are the Lord. You are our shepherd. And we can truly say we lack nothing. We may not have always gotten what we wanted, but you have met every one of our needs. And if the truth be told, you've given us some of the desires of our heart. You blessed us even when we didn't ask for it. Hallelujah. We say thank you. Thank you, oh God, for all the ways that you have sent ravens by the brook and you blessed us in and out of season. That even in a pandemic, you have preserved us and you have made a way. We haven't been put outdoors. We haven't slept on a park bench. As a matter of fact, you blessed us in spite of this pandemic and in spite of inflation. Our cars keep rolling. Somehow we still find money to pay for gas and to pay for food despite inflation. And then on top of all of that, with all of the inflation that we're experiencing, you still keep blessing this church to be a blessing. We say thank you today. We realize we don't just live by income, we live by increase. Thank you that you make all grace abound toward us so that in every circumstance, in every situation, we have more than enough because we serve the God who is more than enough. Now bless every gift and bless every giver. Let it be more than sufficient to transform your world into the kingdom of God. We give you praise now in Jesus' name as we bring our gifts with joy and thanksgiving. And all the people of God said together, amen. If you will come from wherever you are and bring your gifts, the deacons are here to receive your gifts. The finance team is up here to receive your electronic debit. If you will just come from wherever you are and bring your gifts to the Lord at this time. Sean is coming at this time, and then we will have the introduction of our preacher and then the music ministry and the preacher. Say amen as they come in that order.
Amen. Good morning, Christ Missionary. Jeremiah 3:15, the New Living Translation says, "And I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will guide you with knowledge and understanding." How many of you would agree with me that we have a shepherd after God's own heart who guides us with knowledge and with understanding? Amen. As she stated yesterday, the women went to see the woman king, and I just want to say we have our very own General Naniska, a warrior woman who fights for our souls. For the past almost 28 years, Dr. Stewart has led this congregation with commitment, dedication, and faithfulness to God and to God's people. Also in that movie, it was stated that vision is being able to see what others cannot see. Dr. Stewart has also led this congregation with vision, with skillful hands, and with integrity of heart. It has been said that October is Clergy Appreciation Month, and we don't want to let October in without showing our pastor, this great woman of God, that we appreciate her, that we love her, and that we celebrate her. In a few moments, you will see on the screen ways that you can show Pastor your appreciation. And on the fifth Sunday, we invite you to join us in celebrating Pastor for Clergy Appreciation Month. I want to point out in particular that registries have been set up. If you would like to, as Pastor Chuck stated the other week, bless Pastor. She has been blessed by God to purchase a new home. And registries have been set up if you would like to, amen. If you would like to be a blessing to Pastor for her new home. Pastor, we love you, we appreciate you, and we are inviting the congregation once again to just show Dr. Stewart how much we love and appreciate her. Amen, amen.
Introduction.
Described as a transformational preacher, dynamic leader, and ministry trailblazer, Reverend Dr. Jacqueline A. Thompson is an inspiring example of what God can do with a life committed to the call. She currently serves as the beloved senior pastor of the historic Allen Temple Baptist Church in her native Oakland, California. Having been raised, licensed, and ordained at Allen Temple, her ministry came full circle when in 2010, she was installed as the assistant pastor and then called as senior pastor in 2019. She is the first woman to serve in both leadership capacities in the church's 100-year history. Committed to excellence in scholarship, she is a graduate of the University of California, Berkeley, Howard University School of Divinity, and Fuller Theological Seminary. Dr. Thompson is a celebrated author and the recipient of numerous honors, awards, and accolades. She is nationally and internationally sought after, ministering as preacher, lecturer, and revivalist at churches, conferences, retreats, and seminaries. Dr. Thompson is the newly appointed second vice president of the Progressive National Baptist Convention. Her mission is to see transformation in the lives of others by elevating, enlightening, and expounding upon the Word of God. CNBC is pleased to welcome Reverend Dr. Jacqueline Thompson.
Hallelujah. Now, I got to set this song up a little bit because Thursday night we had some conversation, a little talking in rehearsal. And I was talking about, I shared this picture on my phone when I went to this restaurant and there was a group of ladies at the table. It was four ladies at the table. And there was one lady that had on this royal blue suit with a royal blue hat. She looked like she was on her way to London to pay honor to Queen Elizabeth. She looked that good. She was sitting at the table, and I could overhear the other women at the table saying, you know, it's just a bit much. It's a bit much. They were talking about her outfit. They thought she had overdone it. And I turned around, and I said, bless, she is sharp as a tack. When I went by that table, I said, ma'am, this whole get up right here, everything you got, this right here, ma'am, you are killing it with this outfit. You look amazing. She turned around and said, I told you so. I was talking about confidence. Confidence, I made this statement, and Alicia said, I wrote this down because I had to keep this statement for myself. Confidence, just because it's quiet doesn't mean it's silent.
That's right.
Now, I'm going to give you an example. When Dr. Stewart and Dr. Thompson walked into the room, they didn't say a word. But as soon as they went to their seats, the presence was like, oh. You felt their presence.
Right.
I'm looking at the congregation, and there are certain people that stick out because you sit in a place of confidence.
That's right.
And so this song we're about to sing is talking about the confidence that we have from the Lord.
Yeah, right.
I mean, confidence that when I come into a room, it's not arrogance, it's not me being uppity. I don't think more of myself than I ought to, but I stand very firmly and assured in who he's called me to be. That's the from today.
That's right.
So lift your hand and say, I got confidence from the Lord.
I got confidence.
Come on, I got confidence from the Lord.
I am confident of this very thing that the Lord, everybody. Come on, I know you don't know me, but praise the Lord, everybody. All you ever need to know, despite what the introduction said, is I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Now, if you are confident that God saved you, that he'll do everything he spoke over you, come on, don't play with it today. Stand on your feet. Magnify the Lord with me. Because despite what you're going through, the Lord is good, and he's good all the time. I would have fainted had I not believed I would live to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And if you don't believe it, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. I promise you he's going to strengthen your heart. Come on, Christ missionary. This is the day the Lord has made. And since he woke me up, I will rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, keep clapping. Let's celebrate God for your wonderful pastor. There is only one Reverend Dr. Gina M. Stewart. Come on, we thank God for her. Come on, keep clapping. For the gift that is Minister Alicia, we thank God for you. Come on, keep clapping. It's Sisterhood Sunday. So for all of the sisters who have ministered to us, and to all of you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, those of you who are here and viewing us online, some trust in horses, and some trust in chariots. But I decided a long time ago, you might as well trust in the name of the Lord. Because I promise you, Dr. Stacy, it is a strong tower where the righteous can run therein and be saved. I count it an honor and a privilege, first of all, just to be alive. Because I'm not like some of you. I don't live so good all the time. But morning by morning, anybody grateful for mercy that's new every single morning? And I'm certainly excited to be here with you this day on Sisterhood Sunday. I bring you greetings from Allen Temple Baptist Church, where I am blessed to serve as the senior pastor. And I certainly want to extend my heartfelt thanks and appreciation because your pastor came and preached the installation sermon. And preached it, God knows she did. And so on behalf of all of us around the nation and even the world, we just want to thank you for sharing her with the rest of the world, because she is indeed a trailblazer. She sets a standard. And so many of us, the only reason we are able to do it is because we've watched her do it, and do it with grace, and do it with dignity, and do it with the anointing of God. So come on, one more time, let's celebrate. I'm so deeply, deeply grateful. Before we go to the scripture text, let me just say this to you, Minister Alicia, because you don't know. My mother passed in November 2021. And motherhood is a funny, funny thing. You can have your seats. But when you were blessed to have a good one, and I know everybody love their mama, but you know what I mean? I mean, I had a good one. And so I was heartbroken and devastated. And I go in and out of that still. But in December of 2021, a friend of mine came to visit me. And if I'm honest, Pastor Stewart, I didn't want no visitors. I just buried my mama. I won't entertain nobody. But she said to me, she said, no, I'm just going to come. You don't have to do anything. I'm going to get my own room. I said, bless the name of the living God. And she said, but a friend of ours is in concert, and I want you to go. I didn't even want to do that. It was after a church on Sunday, but I said, okay, I'm going to go. And the concert was Damien Sneed. Yeah. And as a part of that tour, Minister Alicia was there. And they ministered a song that they had ministered for, God rest her soul, Dr. Iona Locke. And it blessed me in ways, and I was not able to say thank you, but I thank you for the gift that you are and for how you allow the Lord to use you. Come on, we celebrate her. I know we have to go to the table, and my flight don't leave till 6 o'clock. Hallelujah. So we can be together a long time, but the length of our time together is not up to me. It's not even up to the Holy Ghost. It's up to you. So let's test and see how long we're going to be together. Can the church shout glory? See, I don't see. That's 5:30. We can just shut in right here. Can the church shout hallelujah? That's what I'm talking about. Come on. On this Sisterhood Sunday, I hope you don't mind if we go to a very familiar text. You all have heard it many times before, but we are hoping that the Holy Spirit can speak something new into our hearts. Is that all right? We're going to Matthew chapter 15, reading for your hearing, starting at verse 21. This is the New International Version, once again, for those of you who are joining us at home. We're going to Matthew chapter 15, starting at verse 21. This is the New International Version. We're grateful, as always. Every pastor is grateful for the media team for putting everything on the screen. Hallelujah. The Bible says, leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." And then he answered her and said, "I was only sent to the lost sheep of Israel." But the woman came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, help me." He replied, "It is not right for me to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said, "but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. I know you may not understand it on this Sisterhood Sunday. Just know that I like it like that. But I need you to help the preacher. Is that all right? Just look at somebody and tell them, get it for yourself. If they don't say nothing, they the wrong one. Turn around, find somebody else and say, get it for yourself. Come on, as you take your seats, find one more person. And you put your finger in their face and say, get it for yourself. If you get it today, you're going to get it for yourself. I'm so very excited to be here with you today, not just because it is the Great Christ Missionary Baptist Church, but I'm excited to be here because it's Sisterhood Sunday, the day where we lift up what it means to have solidarity based on our shared causes and our shared concerns and our shared experiences. I'm excited and grateful to be here on this day in particular because you don't have to live long to know there is power in sisterhood. Is there anybody that can testify wonderful things happen when sisters actually get together? So much so that about 3 years ago, the Harvard Review Business Review, they started a series of podcasts entitled The Power of Sisterhood, and they came to two very interesting conclusions. The first conclusion they came to is that sisterhood is necessary. That in order for you to have success in any realm of your life, you need a group of like-minded people who share your goals and your values and who want to see you win, who are concerned about your best interests. You need a group that really is like a sisterhood or a brotherhood in your life. I don't need everybody. I just need about 10 folk who are able to say, "I'm only where I am because God placed people in my circle that when I didn't know what to do for myself, they stepped in and intervened on my behalf." Is there anybody that recognizes you are not where you are on your own? But whether they're here or whether they're gone, that God surrounded you with some people that interceded for you when you didn't know how to intercede for your sisterhood is necessary. But the second conclusion they came to is that sisterhood is scarce. Because the truth of the matter is we are living in patriarchal times where women are often pitted as competition against one another. But can I let you know something today? I don't have to be a carbon copy of you to be your sister. That I can encourage you, I can still pray for you, and still be fully me. Thank God we got women in Christ Missionary Baptist Church that are secure enough in who they are in God that they they can encourage each other and love each other and support each other without having to become carbon copies. They said that sisterhood is necessary, but sisterhood is scarce. There is no better place than the black church to look and see the power of sisterhood. Because whatever it is that you need, if you in a black church, it's some sisters that can get it done. If it's a scholarship for your child, just call two or three sisters. They're going to make it happen. If it's a repass because somebody has passed away, just call a couple of sisters. She going to make a peach cobbler. She going to fry some chicken. And we're going to call the best making collard green maker in the good. In the black church, you always see examples of sisterhood. Isn't that what Dr. Cheryl Townsend Jukes reminded us of? Where would we be if it wasn't for the women? But even walking the biblical text, you see examples of sisterhood. You got bitter Naomi, but she had a sister named Ruth that stuck with her to the very end, and both of their futures changed. You got them two Hebrew midwives who stuck together and God used them to save a generation from genocide. You got them sisters, Deborah and Yael, who showed us how to defeat the enemy on the battlefield and at your kitchen table. You always have models of sisterhood in the biblical text because God has always celebrated the gifts and the talents and the skills of women. But can I be honest? Despite all of the benefits of sisterhood, despite all of the gifts that come with being united with other like-minded folk, there are still challenges we face. If the pandemic didn't do anything, it revealed everything that was broken. A broken healthcare system, where we have to fight for access, where certain people had access to the vaccine and other people who looked a certain way did not. A broken education system where some people had internet and they were able to do school well and other people still don't have it. A broken justice system where we are still fighting just being black in public and being able to survive. And can I tell the real truth? The pandemic even revealed what was broken in the church. Not this church, because we know everything right. This church, I'm talking about them other churches that I go to. But not only did it reveal what's broken the church, it revealed what was broken us. Because here's what I learned in the pandemic. There's a difference between membership and discipleship. Membership was concerned about how long we were going to be closed and what was going to happen to the building while we were closed. And when were we going to open back up? But disciples didn't care how long we were closed because they understood they had a relationship with God, and I can praise God anywhere. There are some things that you have to have for yourself. There are certain things you have to possess on your own. And what the pandemic taught us is that we need some things for, you need your own prayer life. You need your own praise. You need your own salvation. You need to be able to access God for yourself, whether the building is open or whether the building is closed. I need a few folk. We thank God for you, but I don't need no praise team. I don't need no drums. I don't need no. When I think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul. Members wanted to know, are we still taking in good money? But disciples wanted to know, how can I help with the feeding program? Members wanted to know, are you really going to let them homeless people come in the building? But disciples said, Pastor, do you need us to come down and volunteer and clean after they leave? There's a difference between membership and discipleship. Which is why everybody can't be in the sisterhood. Because when you got disciples in the sisterhood, you ain't got to tell them what you're going through. They can look in your face and know what to pray. When you got disciples in the sisterhood, you don't have to tell them your situation. They'll pass by you and put money in your hand. When you got disciples. So the Bible says, that after Jesus had walked on water, after he had crossed Lake Genesaret, he's trying to train the disciples and prepare them for his leaving. After he had been confronted by the Pharisees, who were members and not disciples, and they confronted him on his gospel, the Bible says he went to Tyre and Sidon, and behold, there was a woman. Because there's always a woman. Even when they say it shouldn't be a woman, it's still a woman. Even when they try and stop it from being a woman, they're still a woman. I need some woman that knows what it feels like to be blocked out and boxed out, but God still opens a door and makes for you anyway. I need some sister to know that you only where you are because another sister came and blazed the trail so you knew which way to walk. Anybody know there's always? I know y'all don't believe it. I didn't come to hurt your feelings, but the Bible says that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And when everything was done, he reached up and got some soil from the ground, breathed into it, and man became a living being. But when he looked at all of it, he said, it's good, but it ain't finished yet. And because he knew Adam might protest, he put him to sleep on the matter and reached inside of him and formed a woman, bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, so much so that when Adam came out of a coma, he said, my God. And then when he decided to bring salvation, he said, come here, Mary. And wrapped himself in flesh and put himself in the belly of a what? A woman, and delivered himself and brought salvation. Because there's always. The Bible says, behold, a woman, but not just any woman. She was a Canaanite woman. Which meant she was a woman that knew what it felt like to be talked about. She knew what it felt like to be rejected from the sisterhood. Because, you know, sometimes the sisterhood forgets how they got in. And then they want to set rules and regulations on how you got to be in order for you to become a part of the sisterhood. But I need a few rejects that are recovering like me, who didn't grow up knowing all the rules, that wasn't a part of no debutante ball, that grew up on the wrong side of the tracks and didn't really know what fork to hold and what glass to use, but God still placed you in rooms that you never knew. I need a few folk that know when God's favor is on your life, it don't matter the rules they set to keep you out, that God will bring the whole thing down just to let you in. The Bible says she was a Canaanite woman, a part of the ethnic group that was a mortal enemy of the Israelite nation. She had no business talking to Jesus. Not only because she was uncovered without a husband or a brother, but she was an enemy of the state. What are you doing talking to the Savior? And I wonder if we could expand our sisterhood if we relax some of the rules of what it meant to come in, because everybody in the sisterhood ain't going to have the right length of their skirt. They're not going to look the way you expect them to look. They're not going to behave the way you expect them to behave. But I need somebody that knows God is raising up a new generation in order to be able to reach our grandkids and our great-grands. The Bible says that when she heard that Jesus was in the vicinity, she came out from where she was. Mess me up. Because y'all said she was a heathen. So what she know about Jesus? That's why you got to be careful how you judge other people. Because they may not look like they know Jesus, and they may not dress like they know Jesus, and they may not live like you think they ought to live, but I promise you, it's some folk that know Jesus right now sleeping on the streets. And if we ever gonna be able to reach them, we have to relax some of the things that are keeping people out of them. Don't care how you look, just come. Don't care how you dress, just come. I can deal with your smell one Sunday, just come. Because my grandmother taught me you can't clean a fish you ain't caught yet. You first got to catch the fish before you can clean. I need somebody that's honest enough to say I didn't always live like this. I didn't always look like this. But some folk taught me what it meant to be a... The Bible says that when she heard Jesus was in the vicinity, she came where he was because she had a situation. And that's why you have to have some things for yourself, because there's some things that the sisterhood can't handle for you. It's some things you have to know how to deal with for yourself. She said, look, I'm not even coming for me, but I got a daughter that's cruelly demon possessed. And you pray one way when you're praying for you, but when you're praying for your child, I need some mothers to testify that when you interceding for your child, for your offspring, it's a different kind of desperation. The Bible says she broke every rule to try and get to the one that she knew could change her situation. I would have been all right. But it says she came crying out to Jesus and said, I need you to help me. And Jesus didn't say nothing. Now, y'all told me in Vacation Bible School that Jesus is on the main line. Did anybody get, y'all went to the same Vacation Bible School? Jesus is on the main line. Tell him, talk to me in the church today. And then the second part, Minister Alicia, they said, call him up. Call him up. And tell him, she called him up and he didn't say. But she models for us how we're going to need to be and what we need to have if we're going to get what it is we believe in God for ourselves. The Bible says that she wasn't deterred because she came with an intention to get something from God. And what I'm trying to say to you today is when you come into the house of God, you ought to have an intention or an expectation for something. That I need you to God. If you don't do this, it's not going to get done. That I didn't just come to church the way I used to come pre-pandemic because there's too much coming on. When I walk through the door, I have an expectation that the Lord is going to meet me there. That the Lord is going to intervene in my situation. That the Lord is going to answer my prayer. That the Lord is going to give me revelation. The Bible says. She came out from where she was, had a conversation with Jesus. Jesus didn't say nothing. But she models for us. The first thing when you are trying to get something for yourself is you have to be willing to come out of your comfort zone. So many of us, as a result of the pandemic, we just got comfortable. I have to admit it, even as pastor, I was comfortable dressing from the top up. Can I talk to, y'all did it too on your job, in your Zoom meeting, pajamas on the bottom, got dressed. Talk to me in the sanctuary, dressed from the top up. If you stand up, your whole department gonna know the real story. But she was willing to come out of her comfort zone in order to get what it is she needed from God. That's the only way the woman with the issue of blood got healed. Because she wasn't supposed to be in public. She wasn't supposed to be in the crowd. But she knew she needed it for herself. So she was willing to be uncomfortable in order to get what it is she needed from God. Because sometimes the answer that you need is not convenient. It's not going to make you feel good. But the Bible says she came out from where she was, had a conversation with Jesus, and Jesus didn't say. But the second thing she models for us is how to persevere through silence. And can we tell the real truth? Sometimes we pray and God don't say, talk to me. I got anybody honest enough to admit that sometimes we pray, God don't say nothing, then we fast and pray. God don't say nothing, then we give, fast and pray. And God don't say nothing. But here is what I've come to know. That sometimes the silence of heaven is just God preparing the situation and God preparing you for what it is he's trying to do in your life. So you have to learn how to persevere when heaven ain't saying nothing, because every delay is not a denial. Sometimes God uses silence to settle your spirit. Sometimes God uses silence to stretch your faith. Sometimes God will use silence to steady your feet. That's why the saints of old used to sing, "You can't make me doubt him." I don't need everybody, because everybody don't know what they claim to know. But I need some folk that know something about God that say, if he don't never move, you can't make me doubt him, because I know too much about him. The Bible says she went to Jesus and told him the situation. Jesus didn't say nothing. And I'm okay with the silence of God. What I'm not okay with is the conversation of his disciples. Because the Bible says, here come the disciples, saying, send her away. She crying out after us. That's your first mistake. I'm not crying out after you, because you can't do nothing for me. I'm crying out after the living God who got the power to change my situation. And if God ain't said nothing on my situation, then you shouldn't be speaking on it either. I can deal with the silence of heaven. It's the talking disciples who always got something to say, who always got an opinion but ain't got no power, who always. Bible says, they said, send her away. She crying out after us. Ain't nobody crying out after you, Peter. Ain't nobody looking for you, Andrew. We're not checking for you, James and John. Y'all trying to figure out who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. I'm trying to get my daughter delivered. Jesus finally looks at her. And he said, I didn't come for your kind. I only came for the lost sheep in the house of Israel. Mess me up because y'all told me that Jesus loves everybody. Jesus loves the little children, all the little children. Red and yellow. Talk to me. They are precious. Jesus loves. That's what y'all told me. But here comes one of the little children, and Jesus said, I didn't come for your kind. Mess me up. But she shows us something. That sometimes when you can't get your prayer through, sometimes you have to change your posture. I like her, because she switched it up on Jesus and said, you're not trying to hear my prayer, but you can't resist my worship. The scripture says she came and knelt down before him and said, God, I need, is there any worshipers that know that when you lift your hands and you open your mouth, that God opens up heaven and pours out everything that you, I need people to change your posture. That if your prayers aren't being answered, maybe you need to slip your hands in the air and say, God, I thank you for what you've already done. I thank you for how you've been keeping my mind, how you've been keeping my body, how you've been keeping my family. God, I need some things, but I ain't gonna ask you for nothing. I'm gonna just bless you for what you've already done. Because the one thing I've learned is God can't resist a worshiper. Where are my mothers in the building? My mothers in the sisterhood. Slip your hand. All right, mothers. You know how it is when you in church and you're not with your baby or your child And it don't matter how many children are in church. When your baby cry, you know the sound of your baby's cry. And whether you on the camera, whether you in the choir, whether you are usher on the door, when your baby cry, you gonna stand there for a little while and you gonna catch the eye of whoever got your baby. But if your baby keep crying, sooner or later you gonna have to move. I need you to come take this position on the door, whatever the sign is, because I got to go see about my baby. Don't you know when you worship, your worship goes up to God as the cry of a baby, and God can't stay in heaven without coming down to see about his own. Scripture says she knelt down before it and said, Lord, help me. Jesus replied, I can't take bread that belongs to the children and give it to the dog. And Deacon Sean, this is why I wasn't born in biblical times. Because I know y'all don't know nothing about Oakland, but y'all done seen us on TV. You know how we do. Parable story would have been over. Because I want to know who. Now, I didn't pray. I didn't worship. I have reverenced you and called you son of David. I just need to know, Jesus, who you calling a dog. Now they told me I'm in South Memphis. And South Memphis looked like East Oakland. And so I know some people that didn't grow up in South Memphis where you know somebody calling you a dog was fighting words. But I like her. Because when you really need something from God, you know how to resist rejection. I appreciate her. Because she resisted the disciples. She resisted the criticism. She even resisted Jesus' attempt to reject her. And sometimes we can't get what we need from God because we're too caught up in what other people say. I don't care. Talk about me. Laugh at me. Point at me. Do whatever you need to do because you ain't got what I need anyway. I am not leaving until I get what it is I need from God for my... The Bible says she had two choices. She could have set it off like the warrior king. Or she could take another route. And said, all right, Jesus, is this what we're doing? She said, you know what, sir, you're right. She said, but even dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. In other words, saying, Jesus, I don't know what you heard about me. I know they told you I was a Canaanite woman. And you thought I wasn't worth nothing and didn't have no faith. But I don't even need your whole loaf of bread. I don't need a slice. Because I got enough faith to believe that if you let a drop, a crumb fall off the side of this table, I'm going to pick it up and get everything that God has promised me. I don't need everybody, just a few folk in the sisterhood and in the church today that say, I believe God enough that if God give me a little bit, I'm going to get everything I'm believing God for. On that day, the lesson wasn't for the Canaanite. The lesson was for Jesus. It was the day the sisterhood took Jesus to school. Because he had to look at her and say, daughter, your faith is great. And whatever it is you need, let it be done for you. And the scripture said, not tomorrow, not 3 days later. The Bible says, in an instant, her daughter was healed. Simply because she was connected to somebody who knew how to get it for themselves. Now, I didn't come for everybody, and I know that. But there are some people here today, and you believe in God for some things. I just need you to stand on your feet. You ain't got to tell nobody what it is. But if you believe in God to do something that only God can do, I came for you. Here is how the story ends. What we have to understand is we serve a God, even though we preach and we sing that, you know, God don't change his mind. I beg to differ. We serve a God who can change his mind about your situation. He had decided he wasn't going to heal. He wasn't going to answer. He wasn't even going to talk. But because that woman stood there confident that he was able, she knew that God would never act out of character. And if he knew there was a situation that needed to be handled, that he was more than equipped to handle it. Because we serve a God of reversals who is able to change every situation around. Just turn it completely around. Not just for herself, but for somebody who wasn't even there. Which means you left somebody at home today that God can do for them at home what you need God to do because you standing here. Now, sometimes what we need from God is a partnership activity. Wherever two or three are gathered, he's in the midst. But then there are other times when you have to go for yourself. So hands slipped up in the air. Eyes closed. Even at home, wherever you are. This is not about my mother or my father. But it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister. But it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. I appreciate my neighbor, but God, I'm coming to you for myself today. I thank you for waking me up. Thank you for giving me another chance. Thank you for letting me make it to the house of God. Thank you that you let the house of God survive through the pandemic so I'd have a place to come. Thank you that there were people who loved you when I got here. God, thank you. For a pastor who didn't give up and who didn't give in, God, thank you. Some of us can testify you blessed us exceedingly and abundantly even in the midst of a pandemic. And we thank you for it. But if we're honest, God, we stand here today and we still got needs, still got issues, still got problems, still got children, still got situations, still got health conditions, still dealing with our minds and our emotions. God, we need you today. And you promised us that if we called on you in this place, that you would answer. God, so with my hands lifted up, I surrender everything that I've been carrying in my heart, carrying on my mind. I turn them over, oh God. Diagnosis is, I release it right now. Struggles in my family and in my man, I release it right now. I surrender it all and say, God, you are well able to handle it much better than I can. God, I'm standing before you. And it feels like you ain't said nothing or did nothing. But God, I set my face like flint and I look to the hills from which cometh my help, because all my help comes from you. Touch right now in the name of Jesus. God, some of us, we don't have no particular situation. We just need a fresh infilling. We just want to feel you like we used to feel you. We just want to know that your spirit is still with us. Fall fresh right now. Touch hearts and minds and bodies, oh God. Send somebody a reminder even now. You are yet the living God. And you are able to do anything but fail. God, even when you are silent, I've decided I'm still going to worship you. I'm going to still call you holy. I'm going to call you righteous. I'm going to call you wonderful. I'm going to call you good. Because from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, your name is worthy to be praised. Help me to believe that delay is not denial. That even now you are working it out for me, oh God. Now, God, because I've prayed for myself, I recognize I can't be selfish. I pray for this neighbor I'm standing next to. The person that I'm closest to on this road, God, their hands are lifted up just like mine. They need something from you too, oh God. I lend my faith to their faith right now and say whatever they're believing you for, God, have your way. Have your way right now in the name of Jesus. Do it for my sister. Do it for my brother. Put a testimony on their lips that if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, give them to know that they can have victory. That no matter who has rejected them, as long as you have accepted them, then they have everything they need. God, I thank you for it. Because I got enough faith, God, I don't have to wait till the battle is over. I can believe you and shout right now. So I thank you in advance for what I know you're already doing. I thank you for healing and saving. I thank you for delivering. I thank you for reversing. I thank you for expanding. I thank you for growing. I thank you for providing. I thank you for protecting. I thank you for making a way out of no way. I thank you for the testimony you're putting on my lips right now. I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And if you believe it, the people of God said amen. God is working it out. Anybody believe God is working it out for you?
Turning it around.
you for the testimony you are.
Turn it around for me.
Do it in the name of Jesus. Turn it around.
Turn it around for me.
Sooner or later, God will.
Can we put our hands together and bless the Lord? We dare not let that end without extending the invitation. The preacher said, you got to get it for yourself. One thing you cannot delegate is your salvation. You cannot delegate a walk with God. You have to do it for yourself. Perhaps you're under the sound of my voice, or you're watching on a virtual platform, and you've been delegating your spiritual walk to somebody else. But today is your day to come and get it for yourself. The doors of my Father's house are open for the reception of members. You can come as a candidate for baptism. You can come by letter or Christian experience. But whatever you do, don't let this moment pass you by. If you are watching virtually, you don't have to walk the aisle to be a part of this ministry. The media ministry has placed the information on the screen. We invite you to become a part of our family. Because some things, you got to get it for yourself. Mama can't do it. Daddy can't do it. Sister can't do it. Brother can't do it. You got to get it for yourself while the blood runs warm in your veins. Don't let this moment pass you by. God the Father says come. God the Son says come. God the Holy Spirit says come. As the music ministry continues to sing that refrain.
Turn it around for me.
Can we put our hands together and thank God for this powerful word from this powerful preacher? Come on, clap your hands if you've been blessed. Dr. Dunnigan, would you take us to the table?
Turn our minds and our hearts toward Calvary. As we prepare to participate in one of the ordinances that Christ left for the church, I invite you to the table of the Lord's Supper. I invite you in the name of the one who said he is the bread of life. At Christ Missionary, we have what is called open table, which means that everyone is invited to the table to share, because Jesus made the guest list and he is the guest of honor and the host. So as you get ready to come, I ask you that you prepare your minds and prepare your hearts to be able to take of the elements that we call of the Lord's Supper, communion. I ask that you prepare your mind and prepare your heart, that you examine yourself to do what God has already done for us, to take of the Lord's Supper. I ask you that you will thank God during your time of examination for God who sacrificed Jesus and Jesus who sacrificed himself to become the person that would stand for us and hang on the cross for us, for all of our sins. We owed a debt that we could not pay. Jesus paid a debt that he did not owe. So let us take a moment and examine ourselves, that we do not eat of this bread and take of this cup that will cause judgment on ourselves. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the matchless and liberating name of Jesus Christ. We come before you first thanking you, God, for your love for us, that you showed that you sacrificed your only son, that he would go to the cross, take all of our sins and nail them to the cross, and then went into the grave. And when he got up, God, all of the sins that we have, he left them behind. And for that, we say thank you, God. We ask you, God, now to cleanse our minds and our hearts, God. Anything that will stand in the way of receiving what you have for us in these elements, we ask that you remove it in the mighty name of Jesus. And we'll be careful to give you all of the honor, all of the glory, and all of the praise. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. That Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And he raised it toward heaven and broke it and said, "This is my body that has been broken for you." And in the same manner, he took the cup and he lifted it toward heaven and blessed it and said, "This is my blood of the New Testament that has been shed for many for the remission of sins." Let us eat and let us drink together. The bread signifying the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. And after they had supped, he told them, "As often as you do this, do so in remembrance of me. Because I will not drink of the vine until that day that I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." And after they had eaten and they had supped, they fellowshipped, sung hymns, and they went out into the Mount of Olives. Let us fellowship with one another. Amen.
The blood that gives me strength. Would you stand? From day to day. Today, she's running for office and she's going to share briefly with us. We know that an important election is coming up, and we just want to hear from her before we go, that we might be informed when we go to the election, to the voting booth. Amen.
Amen. First, I have to just give honor and all the glory to God for this amazing message we received today. I'm full right now, because the message resonated with me. I have a child. She was diagnosed with autism. And the doctor said that she would not talk. She was walking. They told me she would stop walking. And we prayed. We rejected that. And so I just know the power of a praying mother. And I came here just to let you all know I'm running, but it's on my heart. It's a testimony. It's a testimony. This child that they told us would stop walking would go on to be a cheerleader. She would run track. She would win medals in Special Olympics. This child, they told us, would not talk. She was a cheerleader. She used her voice. The child that used to tear the church up because it was too loud. And, you know, I thought about how you talked about if you're not the right person or you're not dressed right or appropriately, how we would be sometimes shunned because our child would just be so disruptive. But the message is, and I bring you greetings from Rising Sun Church, 5255 Tulane Road, Aaron Campbell, pastor. She is an usher. My daughter Madison is an usher at our church. And so by the time she got tested her senior year in high school, the doctor's report said she doesn't even have autism.
Come on, let them guys pray.
Thank you.
is making.
Supposed to be Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your obedience to God. Hallelujah.
I'm here to testify this morning, but it was on my heart. I cried my makeup off during your sermon. And I just begin by thanking God. The rest of the praise report is you all. This child, she is enrolled in college. Yes. She's enrolled in college in Arkansas, living in a dorm by herself. So it's not what the doctors say, because I know a doctor. I know a doctor. It's not what the doctors say. So he turned that thing around for us. He turned it around. And but I'm gonna let y'all go home. I'm gonna stop this testimony. But look, it was on my heart. It was on my heart, and it just fell into place. I thank you for listening. But I am Lynette Hall Lewis, and I'm running for city court judge, which is Division II. Early voting does begin, as Dr. Stewart stated, October 19th through November the 3rd. I am a wife, I'm a mother, I'm a civil servant, I'm an employee at the city of Memphis, and I've been there. I have many friends who attend this church. I've been there since I was appointed as an assistant city attorney by Dr. Harrington when he was the mayor, and through multiple promotions, I'm now in HR, but I'm still serving the citizens and the employees. And so it's been on my heart for a long time to put myself out there and to run for judge. And I just have the faith of a mustard seed. And I know, although there are many people in this race that just ran, there's approximately 9 of us in this race. I just know my faith is in the Lord, and I know that he's going to turn it around for me. And I just ask for your prayers. I ask for your prayers and your support and your vote. Again, my name is Lynette Hall Lewis. I enjoyed worshiping with you all today, and I will be back.
Amen. Well, I feel like just saying, just do what you gotta do, cause let's get ready to go. We're meeting in person next Sunday at 11 o'clock. Help me thank Reverend Dr. Jackie Thompson and Minister Alicia. And the benediction is AKAs, get a picture with your Sauron. Women, we need to get a picture. Preachers, I need to get a picture. This is the benediction. God made it fair. We're gonna sing it. God made it.
For joining us in worship today. If this service has been a blessing to you, we invite you to share it with someone who needs a life-changing, transformative word from the Lord. And connect with us during the week on all of our social media platforms, and scan the QR code if you'd like to support or be a blessing to this ministry. Have a great week.
Sister Christopher, help me get them up here on the stage.
God made it fair.
Saints, thank you. Women, don't leave, ladies. We need to get a picture.
Don't leave, ladies. Quiet.
AKAs, where you want them? Where you want us? Okay, I'm trying to give direction. Don't know what I'm doing. D9s, everybody that's part of a sorority or fraternity, don't leave. We're gonna let the AKAs get their picture first. We're gonna let the AKA, and then I'm gonna photobomb their photo. Then I'm going to photobomb their photo. Then the ladies, we got to get a picture. And all the preachers, I need to get a picture with all the preachers. Refreshments are in the back. Lord, bless this food that we're about to receive.
And if
bless
you believe it,
the people that
God
prepared
say.
It and all that will partake of it. May it strengthen and nourish our bodies for kingdom service. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. All the AKAs up here, Kim. Did I see Kim Morgan in here? Where is she? Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Huh. I think Jackie and Phyllis have them. All right. Put your pinkies up. Praise team. You need them to slide over. Praise team, just slide over to the side for a second, please, so that we can get this picture, and then we'll get ours together. Stay right there so I can come in the middle of all of that.
Oh, is it my turn?